First of all, I want to thank all of you for coming today. Thank you very, very much. We're excited to have you here. On this gloomy day, we're so happy Diane Smith is here, because she'll bring some cheer. Diane will be speaking shortly, and after her talk, we will have question and answer periods, and then we will have book signing. And if anybody is interested in doing a tour, please come over to the piano. So again, Diane's going to be speaking, we're going to do questions and answers, then we'll have book signing, and if anybody is interested in a tour, please go over to the piano, we'd be happy to give you a tour. I just want to do a little housekeeping, and by that I mean, I know when you call, you know, we put the ads in the paper, or you get an e-vite, and let me tell you why we need your name, and your number, and your email address. We never used to ask, and we had an event last February, and the author did not show. We had nobody's name, we had nobody's address. People came on a very, very bad, chilly, snowy night, and they were very angry. So that's the reason we asked for the information, okay? So we're not trying to harass you, we're just really trying, in case anything happens. If we don't have your phone number, then we'd send you an email. So that's the reason that we do it, okay? Thank you. We're delighted to have Diane Smith here. This is the second time Diane Smith has been here. She was here in October of 2011, and I'm going to say that Geer changed her life. I don't think that's really true, but we are mentioned in the new book, and Diane will tell you, there is a reference not to Geer, but what happened to her on the night that she came here the first time. And I don't want to spill the beans, but this should be interesting. Diane is a New York Times best-selling author, an Emmy award-winning journalist. She's a documentary producer and a TV veteran. And today she's going to be discussing her latest book, Obsessed, Americans, Food, Addiction, and My Own. And she wrote this book with Mika Brzezinski. Do any of you watch Morning Joe at 6 o'clock in the morning? She wrote the book with Mika. And in the book, they examine the American obesity crisis while exploring the personal food challenges that they faced. I read the book, I have to tell you, I loved, loved, loved it. It is with great pleasure that I present Diane Smith.
Folks hear me over there? Yes? Okay, how about everybody in the back? Can all of you hear me? All right, good. I'll stay close to the mic though. Usually I wander around the room, but I'll stay close to the mic so everybody can hear. Okay, so this is the cover of the book, and that's my best friend, Mika Brzezinski, and we wrote this book together, and this book really transformed my life, and I'll tell you how it got started. It all started with three little words. Three little words that had the power to transform two lives. And those three little words were, you are fat. And that is what Mika said to me. A couple of years ago, we were out on my boat. My husband and I have a small power boat. We live by Long Island Sound. And Mika and her two teenage girls and her husband were on the boat with us. It was a beautiful, sunny Labor Day weekend. And we were talking, and I have to tell you that Mika and I are so close. We've been like sisters for the last 15 years. In fact, we have done everything two women could do together, I think. We even had a baby together. We did. Her husband, Jim, went out of town, and her second daughter, Carly, decided it was time to be born. And Mika called me and said, I think the baby's on the way. Can you? I said, you think? What do you mean you think? This is your second child. I've never had kids. What do you mean you think? She goes, well, I dropped a book in your mailbox about what to expect when you're expecting. Could you go take a... At any rate, we did have a baby together, and so we like to joke that I saw Carly before she did, and in fact, my real comment is that I have seen Mika at angles that only your doctor should see. But enough about that. We were both news anchors in Connecticut. I was at Channel 8, she was at Channel 3, and we really had shared all the ups and downs of our careers. I thought we had shared everything that two friends could share. Turns out there was one thing that we had never talked about that she had wanted to talk to me about. In the 15 years that we'd known each other, I had gained nearly 100 pounds. Mika says that talking about my weight always had felt taboo to her until that day. We had this talk on the boat, and the reason we had it was that we were out on the boat, it was this beautiful day, and I said to her, you know, I said, I never know what to make when you guys come over. I said, because you're on the air every morning, and those of you that watch her on Morning Joe, you know, she talks about the American obesity crisis, healthy eating, what people should eat, what they shouldn't eat. She's always razzing Joe about eating his donuts and all that. I said, I don't know what to make. You're like the food police. That's when she said to me, well, Diane, you have a problem we need to talk about. She said, you are fat. And then she said to me, in fact, you're obese. Now, at this point, I'm thinking, you know, she's such a skinny little thing, I could toss her off the side of the boat. Hardly raise a finger. And she said to me, and I said, you know, Mika, I said, easy for you to talk to me about my weight. I said, you have no idea what it's like. Look how thin you are. You have no idea what it's like to struggle with your weight. And that's when she said to me, Diane, you may be my best friend, but I can't believe you don't know this about me. She said, I fight with food every hour of every day of my life. She said, I feel like I am addicted to certain kinds of food, and she said, I am tortured by it. It is on my mind the minute I wake up. It's on my mind when I go to bed at night. She said, even when I'm on the air and I'm yelling at Joe about the donuts, I'm thinking, I wonder if I could sneak some of those off the set and take them back to my dressing room and eat them when he's not looking. I said, I couldn't believe this. I said, I really could not believe that she had had these struggles. I'd always known her to look like this, and she's a runner, and she always looked great to me, and I was shocked. And then she said to me, and of course, I kind of felt like I got a punch in the nose when she said to me, you're fat. But then she turned to me and she said, you know, Diane, she said, here's the thing. I've wanted to talk to you about this for a long time. She said, your weight is going to kill you. And I cannot sit by and watch that happen. She said, I love you too much. And I want you to be here for me, and I want you to be here for my girls. And that was when I was able to step back and say, okay, she's not just being mean. She really does mean this. She really is concerned. And that's when she started telling me about how she felt addicted to food, and how when she was in college, she would go out with her girlfriends and they'd all go out for pizza, and she would worry the whole time that she wasn't gonna get enough pizza, and so she'd go back to the dorm, to her room, and she'd order an entire pizza and eat the entire thing that night. And sometimes a second pizza. And she talked about how then she'd live on lettuce and water for the rest of the week, or her big thing, now she has a number of different eating disorders that she's had over the years, but her big thing was that she became a compulsive exerciser. So when I thought that she was just running for the fun of running, what she was really doing was she'd binge on an entire pizza or three Big Macs with large fries, and then she'd figure out how many calories she had consumed and how far she had to run to burn them all off. So instead of going out to run for the health and the pleasure of it, she was doing it in this compulsive way, like a hamster on a wheel, to burn off what she had eaten. Well, when she started talking about this, I could relate. Even though we looked dramatically different at the time that we had this confrontation, we're both 5'8", and at the time, Mika was 118 pounds, and I was 256 pounds. And what I started to realize was that even though I thought she looked pretty good, neither of us was healthy. Now, that's what I looked like when Mika met me, okay? After 15 years of our being friends, that's what I look like. That's what I looked like when I came to Geer 2 years ago. So when Mika started talking about how she had wrestled with food and all the crazy behaviors she'd had, I could relate. I had binged, I had overeaten, and then I had dieted drastically, trying to look good on the television. And believe me, I've tried every diet in the book. Every diet. If you can tell me a diet that I haven't tried, I'll give you a book. Because really, Weight Watchers, Jenny Craig, Nutrisystem, OptiFast. I love the geography diets, the Scarsdale diet, the South Beach diet. There was the cabbage soup diet, remember that one? There was the candy diet, the grapefruit diet, the Air Force diet. I mean, I could go on and on, but it would take all day. And, you know, I am not an athlete, but man, if they had the Olympics for dieting, that would be my sport, because I am an Olympic dieter. And how well did it work for me? I dieted my way all the way up to 256 pounds, which shows you how well diets work and the mentality of dieting works. I was up and down, and up and down, and up and down, and then in the last 10 years, it was all up, or 15 years, it was all up. So But truly, when I heard what she had to say, neither of us was healthy, because for her to stay at 118 pounds, not only was she exercising compulsively, but she was also sometimes going to bed at night so hungry that she was holding her stomach, crying because she had hunger pains. And I said to her, you know, that is no way to live either. Well, by the time we got off the boat, I didn't toss her off the boat, we actually got back in. And by the time we got off the boat, I said, you know, I said, I think you ought to write a book about your struggles with food. I said, because frankly, when you're on TV and you start talking about it, it sounds like some skinny know-it-all that's preaching. And frankly, I think most people think what I think. What do you know? How do you know what you're talking about? You're thin. You don't know anything about the struggles of what it's like to gain and lose weight and all of that. I said, if you wrote a book and were honest about, you know, then you could also address the bigger issue that you try to talk about on the air about the obesity problem in this country. But people would have a little more empathy with you because they would see that you have struggled too. So, you know, that was it. We talked about that. Several weeks later, I was actually on my way here to give a talk at Geer, and my phone rang in the car, and Mika says to me, I got us a book contract. And I said, us? I said, you should write a book. I never said us. I never said we should write a book. You should write a book. And she said to me, oh no. She said, I'm not going out there and bearing my soul and telling people about all the ridiculous, terrible things I've done about food unless you do the same thing. We're in this together. And then she said to me, and here's the deal. While we're working on the book, you have to lose a substantial amount of weight. She said, I don't know, 50, 70 pounds? And she said, and you have to lose that weight or you won't get paid for writing the book. So I was I was kind of arguing with her my whole way here, and it's a long ride here from West Hartford where I live, so I had a lot of time to argue with her. By the time I got here and Lynn came out to the car to see me, I think my mascara was running down the sides of my face because I was crying because Mika was being so blunt with me. And I have to tell you that I love to go out and meet people and talk with people and all that, but the night that I was coming here, I was not really looking forward to it. I was so overweight. I couldn't fit into anything. I was worried about how I was going to stand behind a podium and talk and what all of you were going to think of me at this extremely heavy weight. My feet hurt, my knees hurt, my hip hurt. I just really, you know, once I got here and I started to meet people, it was fine. But on my way here, I was dreading it. And that's kind of how I was living my life at that point. And it was because of my weight and how I felt about myself and how I felt physically. So I didn't want to write that book, but she said to me, you know, you have to change your life, and this is the way you're going to change your life. You're going to do it with me. I'm going to help you. We're going to work on this together. So I thought about it, and I said, okay, here's my deal. You have to change your life. I said, because I'm not healthy, and on me it shows. You're 118 pounds, and on TV people think you look great, and they send you these designer clothes to wear on the air and everything. I said, but the truth is, if you're going to bed at night holding your stomach because you're that hungry and you're crying, that's not healthy. So my deal with you is, you have to get some professional help to get over your eating disorders, and you have to promise me that you'll try to gain 10 pounds and not freak out when the scale goes above 120. And she said to me, I don't have a problem. That's all under control. That's in the past. I did that when I was younger, but now that I have kids, I don't do that. I said, trust me. Your kids know you have an eating disorder. They see how crazy you eat and how, you know, crazy you exercise, and that you only have 10 things on your entire menu that you will eat because you're so worried about getting out of control. I said, you need help. So that was our deal. She finally agreed that she would do it. And I hooked her up with a therapist, and she made me sit in on the sessions. And I got to tell you, it was ugly. Because people with eating disorders, it's a very difficult thing to get through. It takes a lot of work. And she thought she was fine. And she argued with that therapist the entire first session. I'm fine. That's my past. No, I'm not. It was ugly. And the therapist said to me, she's not coming back. But she did. She held up to her side of the bargain, and she did. And she is better now. Is she cured? No, she still struggles, but she gained 15 pounds, and she's managed to not freak out about it. Actually, I think she looks really good now. I like her a little bit heavier. And, you know, are people sending her designer clothes to wear? No. But does she look healthier? Does she feel healthier? And is she able to eat more nutritiously and more healthily? Yeah. So we changed that. I have to tell you that I nearly have met my goal of losing 75 pounds. And you're maybe wondering, how did I do it? Well, I decided that I needed exercise and diet. Here's another picture. This is the two of us right before we had this challenge. So this was in, Mika talked to me on Labor Day, so that's the beginning of September. This was July. So here we are at an event that she and Joe were speaking at. So she's real skinny, look at those skinny, skinny arms, and I'm really heavy, and here we are. So I decided that first thing I needed to do was to get some exercise. And because I was so overweight and I'd had a number of different orthopedic problems, my knees hurt, my feet hurt, I had stress fractures, I decided I needed a trainer. And since we were going to get paid to write the book, I had some money that I would be able to spend to see a trainer. And I have to tell you, I found a trainer, my friend Joe Fury, who some of you may know from WTIC and from Channel 61. Joe Fury is a good buddy of mine, and all those years we worked together on the radio, I saw him struggling with his weight. And when he heard that I wanted to lose weight and change my life, he said to me, Di, he said, I met a guy who's turned my life around. He's a trainer, and he said, I've lost 80 pounds, and I'm in better shape than I was when I was in college and playing football. And he said, I'm going to turn 50 this year, and I'm going to be 80 pounds less than I was when I was 49. So I said, all right, I'll go meet the guy. And now if you saw me and this trainer, to see the two of us, you would never think that the two of us would click. Here I am, you know, middle-aged, fat, white lady, and here's this trainer. He's from Africa. It wasn't even 30 at the time. He's extremely buff. He's got long braids down to the middle of his back, earrings, and has this extremely interesting backstory. He was a child kidnapped in Ghana and forced into becoming a child soldier and traveled around Africa at the behest of a warlord, carrying, when he was a little boy, carrying an AK-47, probably as big as he was. And he managed to escape when he was 13 years old, came to this country, could not read or write in any language, not English, not Ghanaian, not any language. Now today, he has an associate's degree, he owns his own business, he's a trainer, and he's the most inspirational person that I know. And here's what he said to me. I walked in that day and I thought, oh boy, look at this guy. Yeah, we're gonna really relate to each other. And he said, but I sat down and I started pouring out my heart to him about how bad I felt about my weight and how miserable my body felt and how sick I felt and how I felt like such a failure because I couldn't get this under control and I could not do anything about it. And he looked at me and he said, all that shame and all that bad feeling, he said, you don't need that burden. He said, put that burden down. He said, that's my burden to carry now. You just show up and we'll get you where you need to be. And I thought, okay, I could do that. I could show up, and that's what we did. And at the time that I started with him, I could not even get up off the floor on my own. Now, we worked out for a few months, and then I found out I needed a hip replacement. So that kind of got me out of the gym for a little while, and it was a little bit discouraging, but it ended up being a good thing. So I decided, since I was going to be out of the gym for a few weeks because of the hip replacement, I needed a completely new eating plan because I'd been on every diet there was, and frankly, I didn't know what to eat anymore. You know, this diet was all protein, and that diet had carbo, and this one was gluten-free, and this one, you know, everybody had a different plan. I didn't know what was going to work anymore, and it didn't seem as though anything was working. So I decided to join a program that would help me break all my habits and start from scratch. So I went to an outpatient, hospital-based program where they start you out with nothing but drinking protein shakes 5 times a day. And then after a few weeks, they start adding food back into your diet, but you work with... You see a doctor every week, you see a nurse, you see a nutritionist, and they work on what can you eat that's going to work for you, keep you healthy, keep you losing weight, and, you know, will work with your metabolism. So that was the program that I went on. And I have to tell you that at 256 pounds, I was the smallest person in the class, because part of this program included going to a class once a week for 12 weeks, and everybody there was at least 50 to 100 pounds heavier than I was. And they were everybody from teenage girls to men and women in their 70s and 80s. And they had canes and walkers and oxygen. And I said to myself, Diane, you have to come to this class every week because this is where you're headed. This is, you know, you're in your 50s. This is no longer about how am I going to look for the wedding? Am I going to be able to get a dress in the size I want? How do I look on TV? This is where you're headed if you don't do something about this now. So I did. So eventually, I lost 70. My husband lost 50, and our dog lost 5. Everybody won. But really, this book is about more than just two friends. And here's us, photo shoot for the book. So here's Mika a little heavier, and me quite a bit lighter and happy. And the book is really about more than two friends. We tell our story in order to show that we have skin in the game, but really, while researching this book, what I really learned is that we really do have an eating problem in this country, and obesity really is an issue that's dragging us down. And there's a lot we have to do about it. So we talk about that in the book. And we really have to have a real honest dialogue about food and about weight and about disordered eating and what it's doing to us. Right now, the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention says that 2 out of every 3 Americans is either overweight or obese. More than 12 million children are obese, and that's 3 times as many as in the 1980s. 3 times as many. If we don't change course, half of all Americans will be obese in 15 years. Half. And here's something else that we need to talk about, and that is the image that people have of people who are overweight. And how do we change our focus? How do we change our image? How do we start to help each other on this journey that we need to go on to be healthy? You know, one of the people that we interviewed for the book, there are many people that are interviewed in the book, but one of the people that I interviewed was the actress Kathleen Turner. And, you know, if you remember Kathleen, 30 years ago, her first movie role, she played a real sexy, you know, siren in Body Heat. And she's 30 years older, she's gained some weight, she's had some health issues, and she said, you know, fans come up to her and they're like, you don't look like you did. She's like, get over it, that was 30 years ago, get over it. But she said to me, you know, there's this tyranny, people want you to look a certain way. And that's not right either. You know, they can't expect me to look the way I looked 30 years ago. She said, if I wanted to be as skinny as the actresses on TV today, she said, you have to make that your only priority. You have to think about that day and night. And then she said to me, some of them scare me. She said, they're so skinny, I don't even think they have intestines. That's another story. But she said, you know, who decides what we're supposed to look like? Well, I think that's part of the conversation that we have to have. What's acceptable? What's a healthy body weight for people? What's a healthy way to look and to be and to think of ourselves? A friend of mine is a professor at UConn. Her name is Gina Barreca. And Gina teaches English and she teaches women's studies. And here's how she starts out every speech that she gives. She announces her age and her weight. She said, this way, the listeners don't have to do the math. Because we all know that every woman is looking at the speaker and wondering, is she older than I am or younger than I am, and what's her dress size? So she starts right out by telling them, I was born in 1957, and then she says, I weigh 153 pounds. In Armani, I'm a size 12, and in a Dots dress barn, I'm a size 22. Because, of course, all women know that the more expensive the clothes, the smaller the size you get to wear, right? So, you know, it's a conversation that we need to have. I mean, one of the people that's interviewed in the book is a woman by the name of Rebecca Poole from Yale, probably the foremost researcher in the country on weight stigma and discrimination. And she talks about how people are discriminated against because of their weight, whether it's on the job or whether it's just in interpersonal relationships. So what do we do about this? How do we come to some kind of a healthy understanding of where we're going? Well, first of all, I think, you know, Mika and I would say it's time to stop blaming and shaming ourselves. You know, me being ashamed of my weight and didn't get me anywhere. And, you know, when I walked into Weight Watchers and the first thing that happened was the woman in front of me, and I had no makeup on, I had a sweatsuit on, I was hoping I could go incognito. Woman in front of me goes, you're Diane Smith from Positively Connecticut. I went, shh, keep that down. You know, what I should have said was, yeah, and I have an issue with my weight, and I'm here just like you are. But I couldn't bring myself to do that. Now I can, but I couldn't at the time. So, you know, being ashamed of how we eat or how we look, that's not working for anybody. And blaming people and thinking that, you know, weight gain is all about discipline. I interviewed Chris Christie. He came to one of our book events, too. Chris Christie said to me, he said, people think that because I'm fat, they think that I have no discipline, I have no willpower. He said, do they think that I grew up a kid born in Newark, New Jersey, and became the governor of the great state of New Jersey by having no discipline? He said, it's a lot more complicated than that. And it is. We need to do more research into what causes people to gain weight, what causes people not to be able to lose, what causes people to gain and lose and gain back. But we have to stop focusing on whether people have willpower or not willpower. We have to think about the media that bombards us with advertising for food that's addictive. And I know, when we started this book, people were saying, oh really, you're addicted to food? What are you going to tell me next? You're addicted to air? But I tell you, the truth is that more and more science has come out since we started our manuscript that shows that people get addicted to certain foods. And it's the foods that are highly processed, that have a certain amount of sugar, salt, and fat in them. And if you think the food companies don't know what they're doing to get you addicted and eat the entire bag of chips, then you're naive. Because they have all kinds of research. They know down to the milliliter of salt how much to put into a chip to make you want it. Not too little, not too much. They actually know, and anybody who's been an engineer knows about pounds of pressure per square inch. They actually know how many pounds of pressure per square inch a chip has to have in order to make you want to eat the whole bag. It's 4 pounds, by the way. So, okay, I'm not blaming the food company because they're going to say it's all about personal responsibility. And my response is, yeah, I ate all that stuff. Nobody made me eat it. Nobody held my mouth open and said, eat this bag of Lay's potato chips. I did that to myself. But this country does not make it easy. We live in a food carnival. There is food available to us, cheap, abundant, highly processed food with all of these elements in it, available to us 24/7. And it's constantly being pushed at us by ads on television, on the radio, and everywhere else. We're being bombarded with it. And here's why I think we need to do something about it, because we have a crisis in this country. We have a health crisis. The cost of treating conditions relating to obesity, whether it's cancer, diabetes, hypertension, joint replacement, is going to bankrupt this country. So we need to get it under control. We need to get people on a healthier path so that we can avoid those conditions. It's an economic crisis in companies and in businesses because it affects worker productivity. And it's even a national security crisis. I interviewed a top admiral who's a member of an organization of all top brass from all branches of the military who've gotten together, and they're one of their main points that they're trying to get across in this country is that we have to change how we eat, because their report that they put out is called Too Fat to Fight. And what they said is that 2 out of every 4 of the young people that come to them wanting to get into the military are too fat to get in. And they said to me, you know, by the time they come to us, they're 18 years old, there's nothing we can do about it. They need to start eating right at daycare. Kids. They need to start at the very beginning. By the time they're 18, we can't help them. And they said to me, you know, it's a national security crisis because the way the military is today, it's not just about getting, you know, warm, healthy bodies in there. We need people with, you know, minds of technology and all these, you know, sophisticated things that we do in the military now. We need the best of the brightest minds, and there are people that don't even get a shot at it because they're too heavy. And he said, and here's the other thing, and this really hit me. He said, think about how, for how long in our country, getting into the military has been a ticket to the middle class. How many young men and women have gotten their college educations or their vocational training or their opportunity to buy a home and get into the middle class because they served in the military and they had military benefits and the military helped them to reshape their lives? Those people are never going to get that chance. Half of all these people that would like to get into the military can't even have that chance, so we have to turn it around. So, I'm telling you, this is costing taxpayers hundreds of billions of dollars a year. People say they don't want the government in their kitchens. Don't tell me what I can eat and what I can't eat. And I'm telling you, the government's already in your kitchen. We're shelling out $75 billion in corn subsidies. That's your tax money. That makes corn so cheap that the food companies use it in everything. They use it as a sweetener. They use it as a stabilizer. They use it as a way to thicken things. They use it as a way to make things last longer. And we're paying for that. And those are all the foods that we're getting hooked on. We're paying for that. And then we're paying on the other end, because then people who suffer from obesity and have obesity-related conditions like diabetes and other things, we're paying for their health care through Medicare and Medicaid. So we pay on both sides of the aisle, right? Does that make sense to anybody?
Yes.
Doesn't make sense to me. So, you know, my old buddy Ray Dunaway, who, you know, I'm still very, very friendly with, he's always like, I don't want the government in my kitchen. I say, Ray, they're in your kitchen. They're in your kitchen. But that's an argument we can have, he and I. But what I'm here to tell you is that we need to take this on. We need to talk freely and without judgment about these fearsome issues, about food, about fat, about body image. What we need to do is we need to push this subject out of the closet and put it on the table. So, thank you so much for inviting me to be here. You said you wanted to, we should do some questions? Okay. Anybody have any questions? Either about the book, about the topic, or about any other thing you want to talk about? I'm open to that. Yes?
Hi, are you finding a difference between the genders, or maybe even in age groups? You're saying it's a widespread problem, but are you finding, you know, 30-year-old women have it worse, or?
Well, the younger people that are coming up, obesity, the question was, am I finding a difference between the genders and in age groups in terms of obesity? Actually, the younger people who are growing up fatter and are getting bigger, and there's much more disordered eating. If it's not a formal eating disorder, it's what therapists call disordered eating. 50% of all the girls in high school who are surveyed say that they have done something to try to lose weight, whether it's diet pills or binging and purging or compulsive exercising, and that's half of the girls and about a third of the boys say that. Okay, so we have an issue there. I think between men and women who are, you know, in their 30s and above, it's pretty evenly divided. Women are probably harder on themselves about it because we're more concerned about our body image and how people look at us. But it's pretty even. And, you know, the health statistics show that, you know, it's a driver for breast cancer and it's an issue in prostate cancer. So it's men and women.
And also I've been thinking, we put so much money into athletics, but we don't help people, you know, get fit. Mm-hmm. And so I'm wondering if you can help think of ways to advocate, you know, that whatever money we're putting into our football and so forth, we have a fitness component to help the people.
Well, we interviewed, I had a very good conversation with the mayor of Oklahoma City that is detailed in the book about how he put his city on a diet and they lost 1 million pounds, okay? And it wasn't just about what they ate. It was also about that, and we go into it in the book about how you have to reinvent a community, because truly, we live in communities that don't provide opportunities for that. We do work that doesn't require physical labor, yet we still eat like we're gonna burn it all off. We eat more than our forefathers and foremothers did when they were burning it off through physical labor. You know, portion size is a huge issue. I mean, there are so many, this is like a many tentacled problem with a lot of areas that need to be addressed. But yes, and you know, and we have athletics for college and high school, and then we have little kids who have no gym and no recess.
Yeah.
What is that telling them? And what is that doing for them? Yes.
Besides your physical trainer, personal trainer, what did you do about eating food?
What I did was I went to this program at the hospital for Central Connecticut, and I it was a 12-week program. I still continue to drop in about once a month. And I do want to lose more weight. I've kind of maintained for a while, but now I want to go back to, I want to lose about another 25. But what I decided was I needed something really dramatic, because trying to cut back or trying to cut out like pasta, it wasn't working. I wasn't getting where I needed to be. So I decided to do something really drastic, and that's what they do there. They start you out with protein shakes that you buy from the hospital. So you drink these protein shakes 5 times a day. And then after a couple of weeks of that, you start adding things in, like some fruit, some vegetables, some protein. I don't know what's wrong.
Sorry.
Hello? Yes? Is Lori here? Who's calling? It's the chef in the kitchen. This is Diane Smith. I'm good, thank you. Okay, lunch was delicious. Thank you.
Oh, that's good.
I don't want to stay home for dinner, but lunch was good.
Yeah. If our kids are overweight, where are the parents?
You know,
don't they have a responsibility, as I see it, to make sure.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
And
we talk about that in the book. I mean, part of, there's two issues. If you want to really boil it down to something basic, there are parents who are heavy, and so their kids are growing up heavy because that's how everybody eats in the family. Their parents who are not heavy, but their kids are heavy because kids don't ever have family dinner, they don't have healthy food, they come home after school or after, you know, being out, nobody's ever sitting down together to an actual healthy, nutritious meal. This one's grabbing this out of the pantry, that one's grabbing that out of the fridge. So the parents do have a responsibility, but Mika's concern was, how do I talk to my girls about their weight without giving them an eating disorder, or making them think that I think that they're fat? And we talked to a specialist about that, and we have a whole chart in there. Here's what you say to your kids, and here's what they hear. Because as you know, if you're a parent, what you say is not always what they hear, right? And I agree, there is parental responsibility, but here's the thing. You know, people who grew up in my generation and the women coming up after me, we didn't have home ec. I didn't learn how to cook. My mother was busy with 5 children trying to, you know, she was a very, very basic cook. I didn't spend time learning how to cook. I was busy with school and activities and all that. I never really learned how to cook. A lot of people don't. They don't know how to shop. They don't know how to buy healthy food. I mean, what we really need is something big. So I agree, the parents have a huge responsibility. And the parents have to get the kids involved in physical activity. They don't all have to join a baseball team, but if everybody went out for a walk at night, instead of sitting down in front of the TV or in front of the computers, be a lot better. When you read about Mika and her family, you know, her dad is Zbigniew Brzezinski, who was the National Security Advisor under President Carter, and you know, he's a crazy Polish guy, and her mother is like a crazy Ukrainian woman. When you read about Czechoslovakian women, when you read about the activities that the kids used to have to do, you know, there's a reason why she's so fit. But I won't go into that. I'll let you read that in the book. But yeah, definitely parental responsibility, but we got to give parents the tools.
Right.
We have to make people aware of what are you doing that's causing this?
Right.
Absolutely. Anybody else have a question? Yes.
When you transitioned from the soft diet after 12 weeks, I think you said, did you have a difficult time? I mean, I'm sure you've had success losing weight, so that's a motivator. But when you went back to trying to eat a normal...
Yeah, but what they do at the program that I'm in was, I wasn't on just the shakes for 12 weeks. I did the shakes for like 2 weeks just to kind of give me a jump start, and then they started putting food back into my diet after a couple of weeks. So I still use some of those shakes just because for me with my schedule and how I travel and all that, it's easier for me to have two shakes a day and not have to worry about all the meals. But I do eat regular food, and they started adding it right back in so that there wasn't that big, you know, because a lot of people have gone, hey, I did that. I did that back years ago. I did OptiFast. And I lost, you know, 100 pounds or something years ago. And then, you know, once I started eating real food again, I had no idea what the heck to do. So in this program, there's a nutritionist and a behavior modification specialist, and they start and they work with, what do you seem to be able to eat? Everybody in the program is different. You know, there are people who can eat a lot more carbs than I can. I can't eat them. You know, they just, my metabolism just doesn't process them. So I never had that, like, jumping off the cliff. What I needed was a jump start and something that would complete. And it's amazing how you really can break your habits in just a few weeks. And that was one of the things I learned while writing the book. There's a doctor who specializes in obesity. He's at Griffin Hospital. And he talked about how you can really lose or drive down your cravings for salt and sugar and fat in as short amount of time as a month. And that's really kind of how I did it. But I needed that. I needed something really dramatic to just restart the engine. Anybody else? Yes?
The doctor's name is?
The doctor's name at Griffin? His name is Dr. David Katz. Yep.
When you interviewed, in the book, you interview a lot of famous people. What was the most surprising response that you got from somebody? Was there one?
Yes, Nora Ephron. I was a huge fan of Nora Ephron's forever. I loved her movies, I loved her books, I loved her essays, and I kind of idolized Nora Ephron. And she was a friend of Mika's. And Mika said, you know, she's a real foodie. She totally loved it. When Mika went to Paris, Nora gave her like the list of all the places to shop and all the places to eat. And she said, but you know, she's always been a really healthy weight and always been thin, and so she must have some secret. We should talk to her, so we did. And we got on, and it was a phone conversation. At the time, we did not know that Nora was as sick as she was, and she died just a few weeks later, so we did not know she was so ill. So we had this phone, we did it by conference call. Mika was at her home in New York, Nora was at her home in Manhattan, and I was in Connecticut. And so Nora didn't meet me, but we talked on the phone, and I started telling her, she asked me, well, what's, you know, how come you're so fat? What's your problem? And I said, well, you know, I've tried every diet in the book, and she said, well, what about Weight Watchers? I said, well, I did Weight Watchers. And well, why didn't you lose weight? I said, well, you know, I did it for a while, and then I gained the weight back. And she said to me, who told you could quit? That's like, AA, you don't quit. You keep doing it. You keep trying. So I'm thinking, oh, my God, I'm finally meeting your Ephron, and I've idolized her all these years, and now she's chewing me out. I can't believe it. And then toward the end of the phone call, she said, listen. She said, I want you to keep in touch with me because I know you can do this. I know you can do it because you've done it before. You can do it, and this time you can keep it off. So you keep in touch with me, and I'll cheer you on. And that was wonderful. And so sadly, she died only a few weeks after that. So that was probably the most surprising conversation we had. When she said to me, you're fat! I thought, oh, wow, I used to love you. Should we have time for another question? Yeah.
Any comments on, I'm just curious to hear what you'd say about, say, group efforts to lose weight, anything from Weight Watchers mm-hmm. to Overeaters Anonymous versus individual mm-hmm. consulting?
I think it's different for everybody. I think that some people really need the group, and that's one of the great things that Weight Watchers does. Although you can do Weight Watchers program all by yourself online without ever having to weigh in or meet people or go to meetings or anything else. So it's really your personal preference. The Overeaters Anonymous I've never been to, but the guy that I'm training with now, I'm not training with the gentleman that I talked about first because he had to have foot surgery, so I'm training with somebody else at that gym. And he had been obese as a kid and as a teenager and even in college. And he said he went to Overeaters Anonymous and he said, here's the thing, he said, everybody's competing, like who ate more this week? On my way home, I had a dozen Dunkin' Donuts. Well, I had 2 dozen. On my way home, I had pizza and a dozen Dunkin' Donuts. He said, I'd get out of there and I'd be so depressed. I'd say, I'm not doing this anymore. So I don't know, you know. For me, going to that group at the hospital, for all the reasons I told you, really helped me because I needed to see that I was headed down the same path. That if this was no longer about, oh, let me try to trim off 10 or 15 pounds. And, you know, I really needed that. The people in the group did not share all that much in terms of us all talking to each other. It was more like we listened to the lecture and there's a little bit of comment. But I needed to be part of that group and to see that, you know. So I think it's different for everybody. I think for some people, doing it on your own is fine, but most people, I think, need a little help. And what Mika said to me was, you know, she said, I'm going to be there for you every step of the way. I'm going to cheer you on. I'm going to, you know, chew you out if you're not doing what you're supposed to be doing. She said, but I'm going to be there for you. And that's, I think, what made the conversation palatable, if you will, to me, was that she wasn't just saying, hey, you're fat. You better lose some weight or you're going to die. She didn't say that. She said, we're going to work on this together. Time for one more? We have one more question? Yeah.
Sorry, I'm tipping forward. I just wanted to say I've read a lot of alternative healing ideas, the Tai Chi and Qigong, and people like Edgar Cayce, Rudolf Steiner. Is everything comes from the spiritual realm. We get feelings, ideas, and then it manifests maybe to words and actions. And I feel like, man, I wish they had told me that about 30 years ago. So to kind of give us all the idea that there are other parts of our culture, faith, spirituality, there might be angels helping us, there might be, you know, inspiring stories that it's maybe not just biologically the food. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, a huge part of it is, and I think I've heard in England, they put so much salt in everything, that poor population is sinking. So have you found any, I don't know if it's too personal to say, do you believe in a greater power? Angels, you know, just your own sense of.
I was raised as a Catholic. I am not a particularly observant Catholic anymore, but I'm very spiritual. And I do feel as though Mika said this to me because there was a reason that my life was supposed to turn around. That living the way I was living when the night I came to here was not the way I was supposed to be living my life. And so, yeah, I do think there's a higher power or someone guiding us that I get some faith from. Because I have to tell you, for Mika to say that to me, for her to say, you're fat, yeah, she says that sort of stuff. You know, she's blunt, and she'll say it, not think anything about it. But for her to then say, I love you so much, I don't want you to, you know, that was coming from another place. And I take a lot of confidence and a lot of hope from that. And I'm still on my journey. I still have a way to go. I don't mean to stand here and say, I got it all figured out, guys, because I still struggle. But, you know, I'm getting there. So, thank you for inviting me back to Geer.